which is God. So let's rise up.
Father of lights, change. You have not done me. Every good and perfect gift, every good and perfect gift comes from you. 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 Father of lights, Father of lights. Every good,
every good and perfect gift comes from you.
Every good,
every good and perfect gift comes from you.
Every good and perfect gift,
every good and perfect gift comes from you.
Father of lights,
Father of
lights. Now, if your father's here, go give him a hug. Good morning. For Father's Day, we have the kids up here singing. It's a special treat for fathers, and we just want to bless you this morning. So we're going to sing this song, And then we're going to have a special Father's Day message for all the fathers. So. Jesus loves me.
Jesus loves me.
This I know. Oh.
This I know. Oh.
For the Bible.
For the Bible.
Tells me so. Oh.
Tells me so. Oh.
Little children.
Little children.
To him belong. Oh.
To him belong.
They are weak, but.
They are weak, but.
He's so strong.
He's so strong.
I said J.
J.
E.
E.
Essa!
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 And what's that spell?
Jesus!
And who do you love?
Jesus!
And who loves you?
Jesus!
Who died for you?
Jesus!
And who's your guy?
Jesus!
The apple of your eye?
Jesus!
And who's your friend?
Jesus!
He'll love you to the end. Jesus loves me.
Jesus loves me.
This I know. Oh.
This I know. Oh.
For the Bible.
For the Bible.
Tells me so, oh.
Tells me so.
Little children.
Little children.
To him belong, oh.
To him belong.
They are weak, but.
He's weak, but.
He's so strong.
He's so strong.
I said J.
J.
E.
E.
Essa.
Essa.
Woo. Essa.
Essa.
Now what's that spell? And who do you love?
Jesus.
And who loves you?
Jesus.
Who died for you?
Jesus.
And who's your guy?
Jesus.
The apple of your eye?
Jesus.
And who's your friend?
Jesus.
He'll love you till the end. Let's give it up for J-E-S-U-S. Woo! And now the kids want to say something to the fathers.
I love my dad because he's smart, athletic, and is a good cook.
I love my dad because he always supports me.
I like my dad because he's nice.
I love my dad because he loves me.
I love my dad because he's a godly influence.
I love my dad because he's always there for me.
I love my dad because he takes us on vacation.
I love my dad because he plays the guitar.
I love my dad because he always does things for us.
I love my dad because he likes making things with me.
I love my dad because he teaches me new things.
I love my dad because he pays for half of my drum practices.
I love my grandpa because he buys me video games.
I love my dad because he loves me.
I love my dad because he does everything for me.
My dad's the most coolest dad ever.
I love my dad because he takes me to baseball games.
I love my dad because he's awesome.
I love my dad because he's the best preacher ever.
I didn't tell you.
Thanks, kids. So now we're going to have the kids go with you. So come on down, kids, and we're going to continue the service. Here we go. I want you to know I didn't pay her to say that, so I know I'm getting accused of that, right? Yeah, sure. Naveen, why don't you come up? We have some reports for you, and I know Naveen's going to thank you, but I want to thank you also for those of you that came out on Wednesday and had your cars washed. Hopefully they came back cleaner than when they came in. We did our best, but we had a great time. But I'll let Naveen share.
Hey, happy Father's Day. So just a report back on the car wash that we had this last Wednesday in support of our Honduras missions trip next month. We came in a little over $700. Praise God. Yeah. So praise God. Thank you all for trusting us with your cars. Like Pastor Danny said, hopefully they were cleaner than when you brought them in. And thank you to all the volunteers. This church has been so supportive for all the fundraisers that we've done regarding this missions trip, and we've met our fundraising goal of $5,000. God's so faithful, but I want to definitely thank each and every one of you for showing up specifically to the car wash, and so thank you. honestly. It's a huge blessing. And just one other thing, as our sixth graders are getting promoted into seventh grade in their, you know, in their schools, so that gives them the opportunity to come into the youth group. So we want to just extend a welcome to all the parents and families of any junior high or high school aged youth, their parents and youth, to come up next Sunday, the 26th, right after church, in the youth room. We're going to have some sandwiches, refreshments for you. It's a little bit of like an open house to get to know you guys a little better, give you some updates, share a little about our vision for the year to come. But most of all, just to be able to talk with you guys in the midst of all the busyness, just to have some time to be able to talk and hopefully answer some questions that you may have. A special welcome to those parents of the youth that are graduating into seventh grade or that are being promoted. So next Sunday, the 26th, right after church, in the youth room. Please come out, and we'd love to just talk with you and just catch up with you guys. Thank you, guys.
I'm sure that you're all aware of the fact that this coming Monday is VBS, which is a huge deal around here. So I wanted Millie to come forward, and Millie, you want to share anything, or do you want to just, well, here, you share whatever you want, sorry.
It is Vacation Bible School. Okay, up until now, it's work, but from now on, there is nothing that makes me happier than doing Vacation Bible School. Let me just tell you, the rooms are decorated, the crafts are made thanks to Gail and Krista, who work so hard. They are doing great, great crafts. Yes, you can clap. And the games are ready, and we have treats and snacks, and we have worked really, really hard. But don't misunderstand me. We're here to lead them to Jesus. I talk to parents and children all the time who got saved at Vacation Bible School. What a wonderful gift to give a young child to where they can know that Jesus Christ is alive and that he loves them and he died for them. That's what we're all about. And we need you to pray for us, because you know what? It takes the Holy Spirit. You can do all the work, but unless the Holy Spirit anoints it, it's just work. So we really do want you to pray for us. We're excited. Everything's ready. We're going to put the crafts out after church today. And yes, a week from today is the last Sunday that the sixth graders will be in our department. They will be going on to seventh grade. And so if they could be here right at 10:30 next Sunday, still, they're still in our department one more Sunday. We want to pray over them and give them a word, and then we send them on. So we're really excited about it. It's a good time of the year. Kids are excited. And you know what? We believe God's going to do a great work.
As Millie said, that we know, according to God's word, we can do our best, we can do all the possible, we can try our hardest, but it's not by our might or our power, but it's by the Spirit of God. And so we just want to take a moment and invite all of you to join me as we pray over Millie and her team, that God would really go before them and that the Holy Spirit would open up hearts. You know, the gospel is a miraculous message. It's got power. We're not ashamed of it. We're going to tell the whole story. And as it's told, there's power that comes out, real power of the living God. And we want to just pray that hearts would be transformed during this time. So let's pray now. Father, as a church family now, we just join together. God, we thank you for this great privilege. What a great opportunity that you've put before this body of believers, Lord, to first intercede for every child. God, every child deserves to hear the truth of your gospel, God, and we want to do our best to preach it, to present it according to your word and with the power of your Spirit. And so, Lord, we ask you now for a touch from you, that you would come, Holy Spirit, and you would touch Millie as she shares. You would minister through every teacher, God, as they have opportunity to share Bible stories and inspire children, God, we pray that you would use them. God, we ask for safety for every child that comes. Lord, that you would put your hand heavily upon them, that they would be filled with joy. Lord, that they would be filled with your Spirit, but that they would know you more as a result of this time. So bless them, God. Bless Millie, we pray, and we thank you for it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Scott, would you come receive the offering this morning?
All right, as the ushers prepare to receive the offering, as we go to prayer this morning, you know, I just really, even in the prayer time, felt kind of a sense of just the importance of really agreeing together and going to prayer over just today's service and just really asking God to move, but also asking God to just come against some things. So if you just really want to, as we pray for the offering, just really agree with me in prayer, I'd really appreciate it. I just really feel a sense of that this morning. So let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Father, even as we prayed this morning, Lord God, we declare you are holy. We declare your authority over this building and over this place. And God, we ask, Lord Jesus, that your presence would abide upon Pastor Ben and the worship team, Lord Jesus. We ask that your presence would abide upon Pastor Danny as he brings forth the word. And God, we as a group together, we declare that you are in control. And Father, we proclaim your righteousness. And we proclaim your justice, Lord God. And Father, we come against the enemy in the name of Jesus Christ, and we rebuke the works of the enemy. Father, we ask that you would come against any distraction, any type of thing that would cause our minds to wander or thoughts to drift. That, Lord, as we worship and we focus on you, God, that our hearts would truly be one with you. That your presence, Lord God, would permeate each person in this building. Father, it is your sons and daughters that we come to you this morning. And we ask for a touch, Lord Jesus, like never before. And Father, those that don't have a father can call you Abba Father. And those that need that fresh touch from you, Lord God, you are faithful to give it. And we ask, Lord God, that again, that you would just cover this building. Father, we thank you. We rebuke everything that would try to raise itself up above you this morning. Those that are sick, those that are hurting, that need a touch from you, God. Today would be the day that you would touch them. We thank you for your presence. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. Bless this offering, we pray, Lord God. Use it to further your kingdom. God, let us enter into your presence as we worship. Let us be prepared for the word. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
You are blood. He poured out all your blood. Faithful, you are Savior, you are friend, you are all I'll ever need, Lord, you are. You are every question's answer, you are every reason why, you are moving, you are still, Lord, you are the Lord.
You are the
the words that I sing. You are the reason I make this suffering. You are my God and my King. You are the words that I sing. You are the reason I make this song, a greater song to you on the earth, to sing a greater song, a greater song to you on the earth, a greater song, to sing a greater.
The more we lift you up, the less our concerns seem to matter. God, the more that we magnify you, we're able to see for how great you are, how small we feel, and yet you love us. like sons and daughters. And God, today we want to let you carry us in some of those areas where we've been trying to carry our own load. God, we want to ask you to come in and be the lifter of our heads. God, I pray for the ones that are just weary today and tired, heavy laden, as your word says. I pray that you'd bring to them rest. God, we ask you that, as your word promises, that you're our helper, but not just any helper, that you're the ever-present helper in time of need. And so, Lord, we just thank you, God, that you know what we need when we need it, and you're right there. And I pray, God, for each person that's in need this morning, whether that need would be financial, Lord, whether it would be spiritual in the sense that they just need to know that you're close, God, I pray you would draw near to them, whether that need would be physical, where their body just needs a touch from you. Would you do what only you can do? You say that we can ask, and so we're asking, God. You say that if anyone's sick, we should ask you to heal them, and we are, God. We pray healing over the sick. Come, Lord, and just be that helper that we need. Thank you, Jesus. This morning, I want to pray. Allison, I saw you come in. Is it okay if we pray for you? I know you're going to be leaving the country on the 22nd. And yeah, I didn't tell you I was going to do that, but might as well now tell you that we want to pray for you. And if you want to come, I won't make you come up here, but if those of you, many of you have known Allison, she grew up here in our church. She's a student at Cal Baptist University, and her school is taking a team of people. I don't think we're supposed to say where you're going at this point in time, but just for security reasons, they're going to a place where that needs the gospel. Let's just say that. And so let's just pray God's safety over her, but also that the Lord would use her and her team and just really let the Spirit of God speak through them and really minister through them. So if you would, just those folks would pray, and let's the rest of us just extend our hands out in prayer as well. Lord, we thank you for the call of God that's on Allison's life. Lord, that she was one who grew up and went to these VBSs and learned your word in Sunday school, and she's gone on to serve you and follow you. And God, we thank you that Lord, she's faithful. She's willing to give up her time and even sacrifice finances and her own personal safety to go and share the gospel in the ways that you'd called her to do it. And Lord, we know that you promise us that you're with us always, even to the end of the age. And you tell us to go into the uttermost parts of the world. And so I thank you for the courage of her and her team. We pray that you would use them in amazing ways, God. You would open doors that only you can open. God, we pray that you would provide everything that this team needs as they go forward. Lord, that you'd give them the words to say, the actions to do, Lord, and the signs and wonders that would follow these things. So bless her, God, we pray. We pray for her mom, God, that you would also keep her in your perfect peace, and her grandparents as well, Lord, as they faithfully intercede for her, God, that they would just know that she is in the palm of your hands, and the safest place for any of us to be at any point in time, anywhere in the world, is in the center of your will. And God, we believe that Allison's in the center of your will. So bless her, God, we pray. Watch over her. And Lord, we want to send her out. God, we want to send her out and say, go and preach the gospel. We thank you that she's willing to obey that commission to go. And bless her, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Ben, if you could just lead us in one last song. And I really would encourage each one of you. Scott had challenged us as well, just believing that there's a point of breakthrough at any time in our worship, that you just give all to Jesus. If you're hanging on to any one thing, if there's a heavy load on your plate, whatever it might be, that you would come to him with open hands like this. This is the posture of praise. It's just an open-handed surrender to God. And just believe that God can do anything in your life. And so as we sing this last song, I invite you just to cast every care on him because he cares for you.
And Jesus, lover of my soul, Jesus, I will never let you go. You've taken me from the miry clay and set my feet upon a rock. Now I know that I love you, and I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend, and I will worship you until the very end. And I love you, and I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you until the very end.
God, we do that now. Lord, we worship you, Jesus. We honor you. You are the King of Kings and you're the Lord of Lords. Lord, words aren't enough to express how great you are. And our words just fall short. But Lord, your witness of who you are through your Spirit in us is so powerful and strong. And I pray that as your word is open today, God, as we honor you through our songs, through our prayers, through the scripture, Lord, you'd come in power. God, come in power and change lives today, we pray. We thank you for it. In the name of Jesus, amen and amen, amen, amen. Let's just honor God with our... Well, today's Father's Day, and I know we just clapped to the Lord, which is always a good thing to do. You know, when we clap to God, I've said this before, it's an act of worship. It's not just like, we're done, yay. It's like, God, I agree with what you're doing. Shout into God with a voice of triumph. Clap your hands, all you people. It's in the scripture, so that's why we do it. But there's another group of people that deserve honor today, and that's all the dads that are here, the grandpas and the future dads and all of you. Why don't you dads just stand up for a minute? It's Father's Day. This is the time where you deserve a round of applause. I was greeted today for Father's Day with my children bearing many gifts, and I was so blessed. So it was just a great, great morning so far, and we want to just continue to honor God and honor all the dads. But I wanted to read to you some of the ways that children have been, you know, you've heard some of these things before, but I have a list of kids here who had some things to say to God, and I want to read to you their perspective on some things that they want to ask God in terms of questions. And so this first one is from a little boy named Neil. Neil doesn't go to this church, by the way, or none of these kids do. And you'll see that our kids are much smarter. No, I'm just kidding. That's not true. That's not true. This is what Neil says. Dear God, I went to this wedding and they kissed right in the church. Is that okay? And Ruth, she had something for God she wanted to just share with him. She says, Dear God, I think the stapler is one of your greatest inventions. I like this one from Jennifer. She says, Dear God, in the Bible times, did they really talk that fancy? Teehee, that was funny. Okay. Dear God, this is a great one. Dear God, I'm an American. What are you, Robert? We could have a whole sermon on that one. This is from Nan. It says... Oh, gosh, I can't even read it. I bet this is very hard for you to love everybody in the whole world all the time. There are only 4 people in my family, and I can never do it. Donna says, we read that Edison made light, but in Sunday school they said you did it. I bet he stole your idea. Sincerely, Donna. This is good from Larry. He says, Dear Cain, dear God, maybe Cain and Abel would not kill so much if they had their own rooms. It works for me and my brother. And then this is from Jenny. She says, Dear God, please put another holiday between Christmas and Easter. There's nothing good in there now. So thank you, Jerry, for sending these to me. But I thought they were very cute. Hey, I wanted to just share first before I share with all of the grown-ups in the room. We have a great opportunity with our children that are here, and I just wanted to talk to you guys for a minute. And so I just want to ask you guys, I know you've already been up here, but I want to ask you guys to get up out of your seats and just come right here to the front. And so that's all of our kids that are in here from kindergarten. I think our kindergartners are in here through the sixth grade. High schoolers, you can just kind of chill out where you're at. I wouldn't do that to you because it's going to be... But why don't you guys just come? Just come right up here, and you guys can just sit right here on the floor for a minute. And the reason I'm doing this is because sometimes I like to talk to you guys, but I try to look at you guys when you're with your parents, and then you're like, are you looking at me? And so I want you to know, you guys, here, turn around. You can sit on the floor right there so then I can see you guys too, okay? And I just wanted to tell you guys something that I told your parents last week. How could you guys see me if I'm there? Should I sit here? Okay, let me do that. I'm going to turn around and come this way. And this is something I told your parents last week. First of all, what I think is very neat is that you guys are all right here at this altar. And do you know what's so cool about these steps for all of us? Many, many times we've come here to pray. And I know that I've been at this church since I was a little boy. And so many times I came here and God met me. God can meet you anywhere, anytime. You know that, right? Just raise your hand if you know. God can meet you anywhere at any time. He can meet you when you're at school. He can meet you when you're alone in your bedroom. He can meet you when you're sad. He can meet you when you're happy. We all know that. But there are some very special things that happen here at this altar. And God meets us in a really different kind of way at church when we're all together in one place worshiping him. And so it's neat that you guys are all sitting here. And I believe that you're going to be around here for a long time. You know that? I think you're going to grow up here. Some of you might even get married right here. I did. I stood right up there and got married to a beautiful girl. And some of you guys will do the same. But this is what I want to tell you guys, okay? This is really important, so you got to listen. There are things that you need to know, right? Some very important things that you need to know. And things that Christians have known for like a couple of thousand years. And there's a handful of things, right? And these things you want to just keep in your mind always. And these 12 things, does anyone know what a creed is? Do you guys talk about creeds in school? Probably not. You see, a creed was something that they had hundreds of years ago. A lot of times in times past in our history, kids didn't even get to learn to read. It's true. Many kids didn't get to learn to read. You know what they had to do? They had to work on their parents' farm or do whatever to just keep money coming in the house. And so you guys are very privileged that you get to learn to read. But for the Christians, when they were trying to train people and teach them what they're to believe, they taught them these things to memorize, okay? And these 12 things are in this thing to memorize. So we know they're very important. And every single one of them are in the Bible, okay? So the very first thing is God is the creator of heaven and earth. Raise your hand if you believe that. God's the creator of heaven and earth. He made everything that you see. Sometimes you might hear a message that's different, right? And some of you may have heard in your schools a different message than that. But God made everything. It's so beautiful what he made. But you know what? Of all the things that God made, guess what you are, each one of you? You're like the coolest ever. You're the most beautiful thing ever. You're the crown jewel of his creation. So the very first thing is God is the creator of heaven and earth. Do you guys want to say it? God is the creator of heaven and earth. All right. The second thing is Jesus Christ is God's only son. How many of you guys believe that? Jesus Christ is God's only son. Yeah, Josh, I'm so sorry about your elbow, buddy. Jesus Christ is God's only son, and he is the Lord of our lives. And you know what? Don't ever let anybody tell you different. Jesus is the Son of God, and he came to this earth. And Jesus was given birth by Mary. Did you know that the Holy Spirit gave Mary Jesus to carry in her womb? And then she gave birth to the Son of God. And so that's the third thing. The fourth thing is that Jesus suffered under Pilate. Do you know who Pilate is? It's not the little light on your stove that comes on with the... Pilate was an evil, kind of evil ruler in Jesus' day. And Jesus got arrested. You know the story because you've been around for Easter. But he got arrested and he suffered under Pontius Pilate. But he was also crucified on a cross. And he was buried and he rose again on the third day. And that's the fifth thing. The sixth thing is, did you guys know, listen, this is important stuff. Let it just sink in your head right now. These are like seeds going into your heart, and they're going to grow up, and you're going to hear them over and over again. That he ascended into heaven. What does that mean? That Jesus from earth actually went up into heaven, and that right now he sits at the right hand of the Father. When we worship God, like we were just singing to him, that we worship God, and that is the throne of God, that we're joining in that worship, and Jesus is there at the throne of God. That the seventh thing is that Jesus will judge the living and the dead. Do you guys realize that every single one of us, all of you, me, all of the people that are here, that there's going to come a day where we're going to be face to face with Jesus, and he's going to be like, what'd you do with your life? And you're going to get the chance to tell him what you did with your life. Isn't that an amazing thought? Yeah. So he's going to judge the living and the dead. In number eight, we believe in the Holy Spirit. How many of you guys can explain how there's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and they're three different, but they're one? How do we get that? But it's true that we have Jesus as the Son, God as the Father, and the Holy Spirit of God. We believe in the Holy Spirit. And number nine, we believe in the church. That, guess what, guys? You get to be God's hands, his feet, his mouth. How many of you are God's mouth sometimes, right? You get to tell people about Jesus. You get to be his hands. You get to actually help people and let them see Jesus in you. And don't ever forget that the church isn't just this building. You look around. I mean, this is a beautiful, beautiful building, right? And this is our church. This is Zion Community Church, right? But this isn't the church. The church is people all over the world who believe these things, who love Jesus. And you're part of that. It's massive, massive amount of people. And we have a mission to tell people about how much God loves them and that he died for their sins. So the number 10 thing is that all of you can have forgiveness of your sins. Now, if you've ever sinned before, just raise your pinky so that nobody sees. All right. Do you know? I like that, Kyle. Kyle went like that. You know what? We do. We do make mistakes, right? But we come to Jesus, and the Bible says if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to cleanse us and forgive us from all unrighteousness. And the 11th thing is that Jesus rose from the dead. He rose from the dead. And the last thing, guess what? There's a great day coming that we were going to have everlasting life, that we'll get to live with Jesus forever if we make him the Lord of our life. So I wanted to tell you these 12 really important things. I told your parents last week. I thought you guys should know. All right? Deal? Yeah? Okay. Listen to the last thing we're going to do, because remember I told you this is an altar, right? And this is where we come to pray. We're going to pray for Josh, because Josh broke his elbow, fractured it, right, buddy? And so I want all of you guys to not touch his elbow, actually, but maybe you can come around Josh and you can put your hands on him, and we're going to pray for him today that God would heal him, okay? So come along. Come. Some of you older ones, you know exactly what's going on. So you guys lead the way, and some of you come over, you put your hands on him, and you just pray, and you just ask Jesus to heal him. And Josh, you just receive what God wants to do. God wants to heal you. And so we're going to pray that. Maybe one or two of you feel a little bit bolder than some others, and that's okay. So you go ahead and pray out loud and just pray that God would heal them, and we'll all agree with you. And the rest of us, church, let's just extend our hands out, and let's just believe that God wants to do a great work today in Josh's life. God, as we sit here just in the stillness and all of us together praying for Josh, we know that you're with us. And as we put our faith together, you say that wherever two or more are gathered together, that you're with us, and you're with us right now. And so, God, I pray that you would touch Josh's life, God, that you would minister to him and that you would put your healing upon him. As we sit together at this altar, this is the place where we meet you, God. And so we want to meet you now. And we want to ask you, Lord, that you would heal Josh. And we thank you for it in the name of Jesus. And if you guys all agree together, say amen. 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 All right. Thank you, guys. Now go sit down with your parents. Okay, so the rest of us, and you guys too, kids, you need to listen. This is good stuff. This is God's word. We're going to look at starting in the book of Timothy. And so if you would turn with me in your Bibles to the book of 1 Timothy. If you want just a very simple title for a very simple message today, it's Put God First and Keep God First. Put God First and Keep God First. And that's not just a message for dads. It really is a message for dads. Dads, you know, you really set the tone for the spiritual climate of your house. That it's an amazing thought and a very humbling and overwhelming thing to think that we have the opportunity to model for our kids what Jesus is like. And moms do a really, really good job at that too. And the marriage is an example of God. The marriage is an example of God's love. And so when moms and dads together serve God, follow the ways of God, teach the word of God, pray with their kids, talk about the things of God, you're making an environment where they're going to learn to follow you. And so I just wanted to give this encouragement to you that sometimes we make that out to be like you have to have a degree in biblical studies to do that, or you have to go to seminary to do that, or something like that. And sometimes we think we're going to mess up the stories or whatever else. But if you will put God first and keep God first, the Spirit of God will lead you in the very specific ways of how he wants your family to go. And not only do we know that from Scripture that you're called to do that, but even in the studies in psychology and things like that, we understand that morality is taught in the home. That in those very first early developmental years, that kids learn what's right and wrong, not from their teachers, not from TV, unless that becomes their parent, but they learn it from their parents. Do you follow what I'm saying? So we have this great opportunity to put God first and to keep God first. And so when we look at what Scripture says, and I'm so impressed with the men of Zion. I'm really impressed with the way that you guys have rallied and made a commitment before God that you're going to flee from certain things and you're going to pursue other things, that you're going to make a covenant before your eyes, that you're going to look at only pure things. And that also you're going to read God's word, pray, and be the spiritual leader of your home. We've all made this agreement to do that, you know, and it's so neat to see it. The men of our church have been reading through the book of 1st and 2nd Timothy together. And so it's neat when we're talking, you know, and just chit-chatting. It's like Timothy will come up, you know, things that we're reading. And so every day we're reading God's word together. And come next breakfast, we're going to sit and talk about, we do these monthly breakfasts that are going to turn into even more frequent things. But we'll talk about the things that we're learning and we'll pray together. You see, this isn't rocket science, is it? It's just doing it. It's putting him first, making him the top priority of our life, keeping in the top priority of our life, and then it just, everything flows from there. And so it doesn't, you don't have to be a dad to do it, but each and every one of us are called to it. So 1 Timothy 4:7, just the second half of that verse, it says, rather train yourself to be godly. Train yourself to be godly. The first part of it, it talks about things that get in the way, things that complicate and overcomplicate our spiritual walk. You know, that it says, avoid these other things, godless myths, old wives' tales. These are things that when Paul was writing to Timothy, that confusing things were brought in, and you got to do this, you got to do that, and all this extra added stuff that's unimportant. What's important is godliness. What's important is the word of God and keeping just to the main things. We've talked about the essentials and the non-essentials. See, that's why I feel it's so important to sow that seed of the essentials. These 12 things that for centuries have been what's made us Christians. It's every single one of them in God's word. We got to stick to those things. The other things just don't have to be the focus of our attention. And so we train ourselves to be godly, it says in 1 Timothy 4:7. And then it goes on in verse 8, it says, physical training has some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. This isn't saying, by the way, just let yourself go and be godly, you know? Eat whatever you want, don't exercise, don't take care of yourself, but just be really, really spiritual. Okay, that's a wrong message. Do you understand that the Bible calls us to this overall holistic life? And holistic isn't some strange New Age word. It's a word that means every part of who we are, every part of our being is submitted to Jesus Christ. Everything. The way we talk, the way we eat, the way we walk, the way we exercise, the way we interact with one another. He cares about all of it. But some of it is just gonna, you know, if all you do is exercise, you can have this great body and feel really good about yourself, right? But if you don't exercise your faith, then you're out of balance. You can have this really deep understanding of Scripture, but you're letting yourself go in other areas, and that has an impact on your witness as well. Do you understand what I'm saying by the whole picture? God wants us to take care of ourselves, but he wants us to have our primary focus. The reason that we do everything that we do in our life is because we're keeping him first. So we keep God first. He's the main thing. It says physical training has is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding the promise both to the present life and the life to come. This is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance, and to this we labor and strive, that we have put our hope in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, and especially of those who believe. The question is this: is your hope in God? Is your hope in God? You see, if you don't have your hope in God, your hope is kind of dashed. There isn't really much else that you can put substance into. God is the strength of our life and our portion forever. In fact, that's what the Psalms say. I love that Psalm. Would you just do some Bible turning and go to Psalm 73, verse 25. 73, verse 25. It says, "Whom have I in heaven but you? And on earth there's nothing that I desire besides you." And listen to this. "My flesh and my heart may fail." My flesh and my heart may fail. "But God is the strength of my heart, and he is my portion forever." You know, there's a kind of a popular message that we hear often is it's follow your heart and follow your dreams, right? If you follow your heart and follow your dreams, everything's going to be okay. We're kind of spoon-fed that. And there's an element of okayness to that. I mean, if okayness is really a word. Your heart and your dreams aren't enough, are they? Because your heart and your dreams can deceive you. Your heart can lead you in the wrong direction. But if you put your hope in God, if you put your trust in God, if God is the main thing, then he strengthens your heart and he becomes all that you need. He is your portion forever. He's the first thing. Now I had you there. Now turn back to Hebrews chapter 12. And I'm going to read you a bunch of scripture, and then we're going to talk about three things, and I'm going to get you out of here for a great Father's Day lunch. So here's what it says. Go to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. You know, this week, as I've been thinking through what to share with you and knowing that Father's Day was coming and so forth, I really had this portion of scripture in my mind. And I'll read it all to you, and I'm going to hopefully just let it speak for itself. But in Hebrews chapter 11, there's this list of people who were just kind of, not just kind of, but they were called the heroes of the faith. They were people who followed God, who served him, who served as examples for us. And they were the ones that are called this great cloud of witnesses. And there are examples that are before you. And hopefully those of us in this room, that we're becoming that example for somebody else, that we're part of that great cloud of witness. That I was reflecting on some of this, some people who've really influenced me. And I've shared about this over the weeks, but there are a couple of older men that have gone home to be with the Lord in recent times that I just really miss. I really miss. One of the men that I told you about, Paul Northrup, who was a missionary that I had regular communication with, he was just a real mentor in my life, just had such an ability to love God and love people and be flexible, and nothing was a big deal. Don't you wish you could be like that? Nothing was a big deal to this guy. He just loved the Lord so much, and nothing was an excuse. All the way up until the point he couldn't travel or function anymore, he was off to Cuba, off to Mexico. Wherever he could go, whatever he could do to be effective for God, he was doing it. Whether he had to walk slower than everybody else or not, whether he had to get pushed around, there was nothing that was in the way of what he wanted to do in passionately serving God, because he was just madly in love with God's people. And I just think about him all the time when I start to get kind of grouchy, when I get kind of tired, when I get kind of bothered by the things in life, you know. I think of this guy who was part of this great cloud of witnesses. There was another pastor who I miss so much, who was a pastor in our city here in Orange. And he was the pastor of Calvary Temple. And an elderly man, and he would sit in his office there, and his office had a big window, so you always knew he was there. And somehow, some way, it didn't matter what time of day or night, he just was always there. Whenever you needed him to be there, he was there. And part of my regular path to get to church here is I would go down Palmyra, just kind of, I don't know, but I am such a creature of habit, man. I have patterns and I can't break them, otherwise the whole world will fall apart. And so I got to go this certain way, and I go my way there, and I would stop and I would just talk to him for a little bit. And he would always, you know, just have this way of making everything that's so monumental and huge in my life just so small in light of who God is. He had this ability when I would bring all these problems that I had or thought that I had just to make them small. And he had this, Pastor John also has this gift. And it's this gift to kind of laugh, not laugh at you, but laugh with you at what God is doing. You know, you get what I'm, have you ever had this opportunity to talk with some people who understand God, they get him, you know, and they model it and they're part of this great cloud of witnesses that everything is going wrong and the world is off its axis. Access? You hear me? Anyways, the world is messed up. And they just go, and they kind of, not in a patronizing way, but in a way of quiet comfort, just say it's going to be all right. And they pray with you and they get you back on target. And 9 times out of 10, maybe even 10 times out of 10, in profound ways and simple ways, these men who have been a great cloud of witness to me, who are really fathers, fathers in the faith, their advice comes down to this one simple thing. Put God first and keep God first and everything's going to be okay. They might say it in different ways. They might use different scriptures to get you there, but that is the bottom line. Put God first and keep God first. Hey, if you can apply that to your life, you got it. You got the secret of being content in any and all situations because you can do anything through Christ who strengthens you. That's Philippians chapter 4. And so that's the background. The Bible's telling us, remember these men of the faith, remember these women of the faith, those who have gone before us, they did it. They might not have seen all their dreams come true because guess what? It wasn't about them or their heart or their dreams. It was about their faith in God to do whatever God wanted them to do whenever he wanted them to do it. Many of them didn't get to see the fulfillment of the promises that they thought they would see fulfilled, but they are written for us in all of history to be remembered as faithful people. Don't you wish that when you go home, you know, I got to tell you, my son, I think he was trying to give me a compliment. He came up and he patted me. He said, Dad, I'm still going to remember you when you die. You know, he told me that. So yeah, I said, thanks, buddy. And then he repeated it like several different ways and several different times. And I thought, okay, anyways, when we go home, when we're no longer a part of this world, don't we want it said of us, and please hear it now as well, that we're faithful. You could say a lot of things about a lot of people. They got talents, they got ability, they can sing like no other, they can preach up a storm. None of it impresses me. What impresses me is that you could say, that guy, that lady, they put God first and they keep God first. They're faithful. And you know what? I think that impresses God. I think that's what God's after. And we get that in this great cloud of witnesses. And so here as we carry on, the language in Hebrews is just so, just really nuts and bolts, right? It removes our excuses. It keeps us on this path. And here's what it says. Therefore, this is verse 12. I'm going to read you like 12 verses, so buckle up. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders us and the sin that so easily entangles us, and let us run with perseverance the race that's marked out for you. There's a race marked out for you. You're in it. Now just keep on running, it says in verse 2. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. In verse 4, in your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. You know, I'm going to stop there for a second. I read this often. You know, it seems like the Lord will lead me there when I'm maybe going through something. And what a great reminder. Hey, I know you're going through it, but you're not bleeding, right? Kind of what he's saying. He's saying to the Hebrew church, you're going to be going through some stuff and everybody around you, they're going through some stuff. But guess what? Folks are dying for this. Folks are dying for their faith. And that's what he's telling them now. But guess what? The same is true for us here and today. That little boy writes this question, God, I'm an American. What are you? God's not American. He's not a Republican. He's not a Democrat. God is the God of the universe. And so he's got children. He's got people all over the world. And in some places in this world, those people are being tested and pushed and shaped and molded and resisting to the point of shedding blood, to the point of losing their life. What a perspective that brings to us, that there's a suffering church that exists today. And yeah, we're going through some things and we're suffering. But what I read here is it says, keep on going. Don't lose sight of what's happening. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. In verse 5, have you forgotten that words of encouragement that address you as sons? Now hear this. My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you, because the Lord disciplines those he loves As he punishes everyone he accepts as a son. And then this is the stuff we love to hear, right? And you go to pastor seminars, they'll go, oh, this preaches really well. You got to preach this. Endure hardship as discipline, right? If I put that out in the city, you know, hey, we're going to have this great series at Zion. Tell all your friends. It's about enduring hardship as a discipline. I got a book to go with it, you know, and we got the Enduring Hardship Band. Come along. You're going to love it. I don't think we would see the place just booming with life, you know, but it's the message that we might need to hear. This is what Scripture says. Endure hardship as discipline. Your sons and daughters. What good parent lets their kids run crazy? Not a good one. A good parent disciplines their son because they love them. They discipline their daughter because they love them. It's a sign of their love. God isn't just some mad, angry, mean old dad who just wants to give you a bad day and a hard time. That's not God. But God knows what we need when we need it. He knows what we can take and how much we can take. And if we put him first and keep him first, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, everything else is added. Endure hardship as a discipline. Why? God is treating you as sons and daughters, I'd say. It says, for what son is not disciplined by his father? If you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline, then you are illegitimate children and not true sons. Verse 9, moreover, we have human fathers who disciplined us and we respected them for it. If I can just take a pause here, and hopefully you'll keep the train of thought, but for those of us that are dads now, I think we need to take a minute and look at this. You know that I actually heard our president, and he was giving a pitch for Father's Day and encouraging fathers, and I don't know if any of you had a chance to listen to it, but one of the things he said is dads, we're not friends to our kids, at least at this age. I thought, you know what, that you can disagree with a lot of what our president says, I'm sure, but that's a true statement. It's a true statement. We love our kids. We love them so much, but we don't like hang out with them. They're not like our homies. You know, let's go. You know, you hear like these ideas that, well, if you're going to go out and party, just party with me, you know, and that kind of thought process that's prevalent in our world today. We're not called to be friends in that sense. We're called to love them and to discipline them. But the Bible has a little key here. And what it says in this point is it says that we respect them for it. Isn't it interesting that sometimes dads, we can believe a lie that our kids are just going to get mad at us? I've been doing some research on the millennial generation and for school and doing some writing about it. And just a very interesting dynamic of kids that are raised now. And there's a thought process. I shouldn't be saying this in front of all the kids, but I'll just say it anyways because, you know, you probably know. But these kids are so strong and they're so smart and they're so vocal. And there's this term called helicopter parents where we just sort of hover around them and make sure they never get hurt, never fall down, and they never make a mistake. And then everybody's surprised that when they're turning into 24, 25, 26, 27-year-olds, that when they're struggling at their work, and this is true, there's research that shows it, when they're having a bad day at work or in a squabble with their boss, they say, my mom wants to talk to you. I'm not kidding. There was case studies. It's so much so that some of these progressive companies are like, well, if we can't beat them, join them. So I guess we'll have Parent Day. Parent Day. Not for 18-year-olds, for 28-year-olds. Parent Day. Come. There's case studies of, I don't know how I got into this, but I mean, I'm here. So anyways, there's case studies of parents who negotiated their son or daughter's salary. So yeah. Well, talk to my dad about that. Talk to my mom about that. Listen, I get it. I mean, I get it to a certain extent. This is just different times, different dynamics. And I didn't mean to get so far off that, but maybe we all kind of needed to touch bases on that a little bit and we can get to it another day. But the reality is this, that we can be fearful of a powerful generation. This generation is powerful. It is powerful. When I say powerful, they have a voice, they have money, and they have numbers. And those people who have a voice, money, and numbers win. In terms of influence. And so we've got to be able to know how we can impact a generation. What do I mean by that? They have numbers. This is the largest generation in the history of America. The largest generation. Their spending power is in the billions, right? Of just what they buy. So they drive economics in certain ways. And they have a voice. They have a voice. And so when this generation all gets together and agrees on something, and they go, okay, we want this person to be president, that person will be president. Do you understand the influence of a generation? And so sometimes we can look at that powerful generation who knows more about math than us, knows more about
technology than us, knows more about world events than us, has had more experiences, more information put upon them than any other, we can get totally intimidated by them. And parents can. And so they might back off on the discipline a little bit. But what Scripture shows here is that your child will what? Respect you for the discipline. That was a little secret that I learned as a youth pastor. When some of these kids that were just from, they're from the neighborhood, maybe their parents weren't going to church, we were trying to reach them. It was like the stronger that I got in love with them, it's like the more that they wanted to come around and be around us, you know? It has to be done in love. Discipline isn't something that we do just to be mean, you know, and just to show that we have power and whatever else. It has to be just. It has to be done properly. If you don't know how to do that, talk to Millie. Go to Mums. Some of the teaching that she gives is fantastic. My wife goes to that teaching. We apply a lot of these principles. But the point is this. Dads, especially, I can talk to you for a minute. Just don't back away. Don't be intimidated by your kids, whatever age they are. Don't be intimidated. Press into them. Press into them. Lean into them. Love into them. Continue to be active and a part of their life. Don't give them everything they want just because they want it. I'm telling myself this. I'm looking at this research saying, God, help me. Because they'll respect us for it. Just as our Heavenly Father doesn't give us everything we want, but He knows what we need when we need it. And we respect Him for it. How much more should we submit to the Father and of our spirits and live? Our fathers disciplined us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplines us for good, that we may share in this holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace to those who have been trained by it. And then he goes on, he says, therefore, strengthen your feeble arms and weak knees. We used to have a youth pastor here. He would say, come on, you girly man. Like, he would just say, strengthen up. You know, he would tell us to go and do certain things. Strengthen your feeble arms and your weak knees. Make level paths for your feet so that the lame may not be disabled, but rather healed. Prioritize, dads. Prioritize, church. All of us. We've got to prioritize. Put God first. Keep God first. Everything will flow from there. I got a little bit more, but I'm going to wrap it up because time is running out. But let me just give you a couple of practical things that says it right there in that those portions that I read. The very first thing is when he says, Paul is saying to the Hebrew church, he says, therefore, since we're surrounded by a great cloud of witness, the first thing that, and a point I hope you can take away, is look at the heroes. Look at how the people who are doing it well are doing it and do it just like them. It's just kind of a principle for a lot of things. Athletics, it's that way, you know, and all different kinds of sports. Look how the people who do it well are doing it and do it just like them. I gave you an example of some of these heroes for me, and there's more of them that are sitting here in these pews, and that's what the church is like, so that we can see in one another the gift of God and that we can do like others are doing. There's one example from Scripture in the Old Testament, the example of Noah. And you got to think of Noah for a moment. Noah didn't give up. Noah had an active faith, a living faith, and he put feet to it. Like, he actually had to do something about it. Let me just read this really quick in Genesis 6:5. It said, the Lord saw how great that man's wickedness was on the earth and how it had become, how every inclination of the thoughts of his hearts were evil. And the Lord was grieved that he had made man and put him on the earth, and his heart was filled with pain. And so the Lord said, I will wipe mankind whom I've created from the face of the earth, men and animals, and I have creatures that move along the earth and birds of the air, for I am grieved that I've made them. Wow. Wow. That's the condition of the depravity of the society that God sees, and he's just like, I'm done. Wipe them out. But anywhere in Scripture where you see the word B-U-T, not the other one, but B-U-T, but it causes you to whoa, okay, what is he going to say? But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. What was this guy, Noah? You know, that he had found favor in the eyes of the Lord amidst a whole generation of wickedness and evil. And there's a couple of quick things I'll say about Noah that Scripture says, 6:22. God gives him these crazy instructions. And if God asks you or I to do it, I hope we could do it. Build an ark, a big, huge ark. Some scholars say they don't even know if people in that time had ever seen rain before. I don't know, but whatever they're saying, there's this massive storm that's going to come and flood the earth. So build a big boat. And here's how you build it, and here are the specs for it. And oh, and by the way, that big boat that you build, I want you to get two animals of every kind. Yeah, just go out and get them, you know, lasso them, do whatever you got to do. Get them, bring them on the boat, and then just wait for me.
And he takes some time to do that faithfully, day by day by day. Faithfulness. Noah was faithful. Do you think Noah was made fun of? Yeah. Do you think he was persecuted by words? Yeah, of course. But guess what? Who went with Noah on that ship? His sons and daughters, right? Somehow, keeping God first, putting him first, keeping him first, being faithful, caused family to rally around a dad to save an entire world from destruction. That's a pretty powerful message about putting God first. It's a pretty powerful impact of what can happen when you're faithful. And you know what? I gotta believe this wasn't some easy job, right? I've built some things before. Many of you have built things before, but I've never built a huge ark, how technical that would be. I've never rustled up animals. I know that the Spirit of God helped them to do it, but we're talking literal here. I don't know about you, but I believe when Scripture says something, it actually happened. It wasn't some fairy tale or a wives' tale about a story that could have happened, but this happened. Builds this great big door. And in this great big door, you know, you picture all these animals coming in. And there's theories about maybe what they look like. There's a carpenter in Denmark who actually recreated the ark in real life based on what the Bible said. I mean, this could have really happened. It did really happen. But how much work would that take? We got to be willing to work. We got to be willing to go for it. And so they get all these animals in. And now it's like, okay, rain clouds are coming. Animals are in. And now what? And I love this portion of scripture in chapter 7. After he'd done all these things, and by the way, it says Noah did everything God told him to do. Everything. He just did it all. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. You know, I think that that's just the response that we need to have. Yes, Lord. We need to be like, yes, Lord, people. I like that song we sing, yes, Lord. I mean, it's like really repetitive. Sometimes we get annoyed when songs repeat, but that's a good repeater. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Let it burn in your head. That's what we say to God. Yes. He did everything God said to do. And now the whole ark's full of animals and all the chaos, I'm sure, that was in there. And he's got his kids there. And I love this. God shut the door. How cool is that? Do you know what that tells me? You just do the possible. You just do the possible. Do what you can do. Love your kids. Love your Lord. Follow God. Follow him passionately. Do your best to obey him in everything. Do the possible. And this is where faith comes in. You trust God for the impossible. There's some on the Honduras team. They're praying and believing and seeing miracles happen for God to provide the finances that they need to happen. You guys do the possible. Wash cars. Write letters. Do whatever God leads you to do. And believe that God will do the impossible. He'll provide for you. There are others that are looking for jobs. Look for the jobs. Get on the internet. Go out there. Knock on doors. Knock doors down. Do whatever you've got to do in obedience to God. And then trust him for the impossible. You see, now this ark is filled with animals. They're ready to go. I got to thinking, how do you shut the door? How would you shut that? That's got to be one heavy door. Don't you think? I mean, to get a couple of pair of elephants through it? Giraffes, got to be tall. You know, I mean, I don't know. Heavy door. Some of you have some heavy doors in your life. And when we only focus on the heavy door, when all we can see is the heavy door, thinking, how am I going to get that door shut? How am I going to get that door shut? I know he wants me to do this, but I have no way. I don't just know how I'm going to get that door shut. All we're focused on is shutting the door. When God is saying, don't worry about the door, just get the animals in the ark, right? Do the possible. Do the possible. Pray that prayer with your little son or daughter before you go to bed. You might think, I'm terrible at praying out loud. You know, they pray better than me. Some of these kids in Sunday school know the Bible better than some of us, and it's true. Don't let that stop you from being a spiritual leader in your home. Pray the prayer, read the word, do the things you've got to do the possible, and then trust that God will come in his mercy, in his goodness, and do the impossible. He is the God of the impossible. So we look at those that have gone before us, guys like Noah. We look at honestly in our own lives through the eyes of the Spirit. Look at your own life through the eyes of the Holy Spirit, and you don't live in the past. The overall message in the book of Hebrews, I wrote this down so I can get it straight. As you read about the study of it and then take the whole book, it's don't live in the past, live in the present as if the future mattered. Let me say that again. Don't live in the past, right? We all got one. No one wants to hear about it. I mean, except for the parts that you understand where God brought you from and giving glory to God, hear me out. Don't live in the past, live in the present as if the future mattered. There's a great day coming. There's more.
But you can't just live in that great day way out here. You can't just live in like buckled up waiting for heaven to come. There's stuff to do right now. Right now matters, especially because of what's coming. And I'll just let that marinate. The final thing in terms of how we actually put God first and keep God first is just look at Jesus. Look at Jesus. You know, our church has a motto, following the ways of Christ Jesus. Man, that is just, you can't go wrong. Look at Jesus. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the Father. Don't look at obstacles. Don't look at big doors that need to be shut. Look at Jesus and do the possible. You know, a lot of times we end our services with a song, and today I want to do something a little bit different. And if we could, let's stand together. I want to end our service in prayer. And I want to end it in a prayer that we can pray together. I love this prayer. It's a prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. And I put it up on the board because some of us have memorized this prayer and we pray it. And so we want to say it together. And so we want to say it with the same words. But as we pray this prayer, we realize how great our Heavenly Father is. Our Father, right? He's our Father. He's who disciplines us because he loves us. He's who strengthens us when we're weak. He's who shuts the door and does the impossible. It's our Father. We can do nothing without him. And you know what? Our Father loves us with an everlasting love. And the thing that I think is really fantastic about God is he loves us and he likes us too. He enjoys you. He enjoys you. He created you in his image. He created you for a relationship. He likes your ideas. He likes it when you talk to him. You're the delight of his heart. The Bible says that he rejoices over you with singing. I know I love my kids. I would do anything for my kids. But you think about our God in heaven who loves you and likes you. He loves you with an everlasting love. And so if there's heaviness on your heart today, whether it's a heaviness of this day being a difficult day because it's Father's Day, whether it's this overwhelming feeling like, man, I cannot build an ark and I can't get animals in it and I can't get my kid to pray. I don't know what it is. I just want to tell you, don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give up. Keep on going. Press on. Press on in the power of the Holy Spirit. Don't give up. It's the message of Hebrews. Don't give up. He says it in many different ways. Do the possible. Do the possible. And God will multiply the possible. And you'll end up with something impossible that only he can do. And so let's look to the Lord together. And we say this prayer together. And then I'll close in a prayer and a blessing over you. Let's say it now. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. God, I pray today a special blessing upon each one that's here, on dads, on grandpas, on moms, on daughters and sons, and the whole lot, everybody who's here. I pray a blessing over them. I pray this blessing that they might be inspired and encouraged, not by me, but by you and your word that tells us it's possible to put you first and keep you first. That, Lord, there's a way to do it, that we've seen others who've gone before us and they've done it and done it well. Not perfect, but they've done it. Lord, there's a way that we can look at our own lives through the eyes of the Spirit. We can repent and confess to you all the junk that we're doing wrong, and you come in and you faithfully restore us, God. There's a way to keep our eyes fixed on you and not obstacles like big doors that need to get shut and other things. But we can keep our eyes fixed on you and run this race with endurance and never give up, because we haven't yet resisted to the point of shedding blood, but we're going to keep on going. So God, would you bless them today? Would you encourage them? Would you bring peace to families? Would you bring reconciliation where there's brokenness? Lord, would you bring hope where there's hopelessness? And God, would you again bless each one today, I pray, in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you and happy Father's Day.